Highway, Rochester. TX Master, VTR 9397, dubbed.
Is this an 800-year-old cathedral next to a massive Norman castle and nearby England's oldest dockyard? And what are 1,000 children doing setting off in a marvellous procession, all dressed up as chimney sweeps? Hello and welcome to the city of Rochester upon Medway. Highway is here this week to join in the fun leading up to the annual Dickens Festival. Here in one of the most historic places in Kent, we're going to see signs of new life growing out of old roots. Let's begin with the young generation of Rochester celebrating an old maytime custom dating back over 300 years. Sweeps used to be called climbing boys. They literally clambered up your chimney to clean it. It was dangerous and cruel child labour from which they were freed for just one day a year. So it was a great celebration. The procession is led by the traditional figure of Jackie the Green. Now, what we know about this has been handed down from one generation of Rochester citizens to another, and by some of our great writers, Charles Kingsley, Robert Southey, and most notably, Charles Dickens.
The great gulf between the rich and the poor, which he wrote about, reflected life in the 19th century cities. Of all those cities, this one, Rochester, is one he knew very well indeed. Let's go and see where he lived.
This is Gads Hill, just outside the city, in the village of Higham. From the time when he passed by with his father, Charles Dickens wanted to live here, and in later life, his dream came true. By then, readers clamoured for the episodes published each week of his novels, and he was famous.
So here we are, at the house where the man who created Mr. Pickwick lived and died. And Pickwick is a character I got to know pretty well when I played him in the musical. Remember this song?
Look into your heart. And what you see, you must believe. Know what's in your heart. Don't wear your heart upon your sleeve. Life is a game, seldom the same. Who knows what's in store? We don't keep the score.
Gads Hill Place today is a school, but just a few rooms have been preserved as he left them. This was Dickens' favourite room. Not surprisingly, he had a passion for books. Even the doorway was designed with dummy bookshelves so that he could feel totally enclosed. Not very big, really, is it?
No, it's surprisingly small, yeah, as I remember it.
Big enough, of course. Now, this was your great-grandfather's dream house, wasn't it?
Yes, indeed it was. He used to live in Chatham when he was a very small boy and went for walks with his father. And one day they came up here and he saw it and fell in love with it. When the family came here, it was about, I think he bought it about 1856, but they didn't come to live here for full time until 1860. Mm-hmm. Just at that time, he'd parted from his wife under very distressing conditions. I mean, it was a great scandal of the time. And so the family moved here without a mother. They would have remembered him as smaller kids back in London, where, when they were really small, the tremendous parties where he was the life and soul of the party, and they adored him. And now, as they were growing up, teenage, they couldn't get near him. It's not that he was a bad father, he provided for them and he set them up in careers. He loved walking around all these Kentish countryside, and they would go for long walks, but they always said, in silence. He didn't talk to them.
What a shame.
And poor Dickens never had any inward resources. He'd made his career by his own enormous efforts, almost nuclear efforts, and had to go on living life in that way. And there was nothing to go back into when times went wrong. And the times did go very wrong indeed. He wrote Little Dorrit, which is about, most of it set inside a prison. And that can be sort of synonymous how he was. And the family broke up. They left here, they left Gads Hill. The wife's sister, Aunt Georgina, she ran this house. It's a strange arrangement for the sister-in-law to become the mother of the family, as it were. She was greatly loved, and she was really the chatelaine of this house. And as Dickens sort of regressed, he couldn't find the happiness that he wanted. He began to find it here, because the older family could now understand him, forgave him, looked after him, and loved him. And the last years that he spent here in Gads Hill were perfectly happy years.
So it's a story with a happy ending after all.
Yes, indeed.
Well, thanks for talking to us, David. Now, before we leave here, we're going to hear from the people who know Gads Hill Place best of all today. The choristers and instrumentalists of Gads Hill School are going to perform for us the Lord Jesus Christ. How do I get out of here? Who's this here? She looks like Mrs. McCorbin from David Copperfield. Surely she can't still be around.
Hello. Now, I'm not quite sure whether you're Thelma Grove or Mrs. McCorbin.
Well, I'm a little bit of both. I'm Thelma Grove. I'm the chairman of the Rochester branch of Dickens Fellowship. And I'm Mrs. McCorbin, and I brought my twins out for an airing.
You're so familiar with Dickens, you can quote some passages by heart, can't you?
Yes. Yeah, okay. I'm pleased that the sun's come out, because it's the sort of thing that I always associate with Rochester. It's practically the last thing that Dickens wrote. He was writing in his chalet on the day before his death, and he was taken ill after dinner. And practically the last thing he wrote is now what we call Dickens's farewell to Rochester. A brilliant morning shines on the old city. Its antiquities and ruins are surpassingly beautiful, with a lusty ivy gleaming in the sun and the rich trees waving in the balmy air. Changes of glorious light from moving boughs, songs of birds, scents from gardens, woods and fields penetrate into the cathedral, subdue its earthy odour, and preach the resurrection and the life.
The writer's love for Kent began when he was a child. He grew up at his house in Ordnance Terrace. His father, John Dickins, was working at the Navy Pay Office in Chatham Dockyard. More than 500 ships were built on the slipways, including HMS Victory. Sadly, the Royal Navy left this great dockyard in 1984. But the dockyard's crucial role won't be forgotten. A trust has been set up, and plans to turn these beautiful 18th century buildings into a major tourist attraction. The person in charge of it all is a man who's shown incredible courage. Former Commandant of the Royal Marines, General Sir Steuart Pringle.
We're standing in the oldest intact building in the country built for the Royal Navy. They're built in 1704, the same year as they started on Buckingham Palace.
How old is it?
It was originally painted for the great cabin of the Royal Sovereign. And after it had been installed at the end of the 18th century, the Admiralty had one of their fits of economy and decided too much money was being spent on decorating warships. And so it was ordered to be taken out and fell off the back of a horse and cart as it was going past the Commissioner's house here, which is where it's been ever since. It was certainly valued at £19 in 1701, and so it's the tail end of the 18th century, or the tail end of the 17th century.
What a few bob in those days, wasn't it?
Oh, £19, yes, great deal of money.
So it's a very rare painting, then?
We believe it's the only painting from a ship's cabin from that century anywhere in the world.
You're encouraging new businesses to come here, aren't
yes.
you? As long as they're involved in old industries, that's important to you.
Well, not so much old industries, but that is certainly very nice, but more particularly maritime industries. We've got 46 scheduled ancient monuments on the site, which is the largest collection anywhere in the country, which sounds terribly exciting until you get the maintenance bills. And so one of the ways we've devised to help pay for the buildings is to encourage, as you say, business into the dockyard, with two provisos on the businessman. One is that the public can come and see the craftsmen at work, and that is obviously why we want the old crafts. And secondly, that the working week includes the weekend, which of course is when the most visitors come.
And of course they can watch rope being made for the Victory, can't they?
Yes, they can. I always put it on in a sort of rather downturn. We spent £3 million restoring one building in order to give employment for eight people. But they're eight very important people who had over 200 years' experience of rope making between them.
Now, you came through a very bad experience a few years ago. Why did you take up this challenge?
Well, I was retiring from the Royal Marines in the normal course of events, there being nowhere else to go. I was beginning to look around for something to do, and the minister responsible rang me up and asked me whether I'd like to do it. And foolishly enough, I said yes.
As one era comes to an end here, there's a lot to look forward to in the future.
One by one, when dawn appears and day has just begun, they will light your heart with happiness, make each hour bright and bring you gladness. Count your blessings one by one, when twilight falls and toil of day's done, and in sweet dreams they'll come again to you. If you will count your blessings each day through, blessings while you may, for we are here but little time to stay. All around our hearts sincere and true, lovely things abound just waiting for you. Count your blessings while you may, the big or small, whichever comes your way, for then you'll find this world. count your blessings from above.
Rochester Cathedral needs a lot of care. It had to be all but rebuilt at the beginning of last century, and the scaffolding is here again. This ancient painting was recently uncovered in the chancel. The work going on now is extremely delicate. One false move, and it'll be lost for good. It's thought that this failed picture marks the tomb of the 13th century saint William of Perth. After his murder, his remains were believed to possess healing powers. The spot where St. William met his death hasn't gone unmarked either. By complete coincidence, the Wisdom Hospice now stands on the site. The hospice was the dream of this lady, Molly Wisdom. But it was a local couple who really got the project off the ground, Harry and Dorothy Rogers. Now, you took over where Molly Wisdom left off, didn't you?
Yes, I suppose you could say that, Harry. She handed over £2,000 before she died to a local surgeon, and he decided that possibly we should get a committee set up. And we called a public meeting, formed a committee, and from then on, it was really the fundraisers that did all the work.
How did you get involved?
Well, I was saying goodbye to a chief superintendent at Rochester Nick, Rochester Police Station, and the surgeon came alongside me and said, you're interested in hospice care? And I said, well, yes, we've got a daughter who's a nurse at St. Christopher's Hospice. He said, well, we're hoping to set up a hospice here. Would you join us? And I said, certainly. And I joined them, became vice chairman. Doug Redmond, the local vicar, was chairman. He got moved on to Bromley, and so I took over the chair. We wanted a secretary. I went home one day and said, darling, would you like to be secretary of the Wisdom Hospice? And she said, well, yes, just for a few weeks.
Yes.
And that lasted about 8 years. And that's how it all started.
Because you were going to be ordained, weren't you?
At that time, yes.
Yeah. Late ordination, wasn't it?
Yes, I was manager of the local radio station here, but I had wanted to be ordained for some time, was training in Southwark, and in my spare time. And the hospice came along then, and I had to decide, and I felt that God was pulling both of us towards the hospice, that was what we were meant to do, and that's proved to be true.
Well, how's it feel now that it's here?
Well, sometimes when I look around, I really can't believe it. But looking back on the 8 years, it was really hard work. But we were really looked over and blessed in so many ways, Harry, I can't tell you. Whenever we needed any advice, someone always appeared, and I'm sure that God was watching us and looking over us and guiding us in all ways in this work. And I think this achievement owes a lot to him and to the local community.
Dr. David Oliver, how do the patients find life here?
The usual comments are of peace or relaxation, and I hope that's the atmosphere that comes across to from the hospice.
But they're free to come and go, aren't they, in certain circumstances?
Very much. We would encourage patients to get out for the day or go home for a weekend and come and go. We had one gentleman who, the day before he died, was down in the pub, sitting out, looking over the River Medway with his friends, having a drink as he wanted to, and he died the next day.
Good with.
He was very appreciative of the chance to do what he wanted to.
Is their faith restored in many cases?
It varies from patient to patient. We'd always want them to be themselves. Mm. We have some patients who we can see a move during the time in the hospice. We had one lady who read the newspaper during the service on the ward the first week, the second week listened to the service, and the third week joined the service. And it was very nice to see that movement and that she was involved in things.
Looking after you well here, are they?
Oh, I just can't say enough about it.
Oh, that's good.
Since the end of November, my life has really been eased such a lot by all the support around me, and I really mean that.
The essential holiness of the Wisdom Hospice, of the place, of its patients, and of its staff, reminds us all of a deep communion with God.
God to thee, nearer to thee, e'en though it be a cross that raiseth me. God to thee, near. steps unto her. Oh, that thou sendest me in mercy give.
Thank you, Ronnie. J.B. Dyke's beautiful tune, Horbury, complementing the story told in the book of Genesis of Jacob's dream, which so strengthened his faith in God. And here we are in the crypt, the oldest part of Bishop Gundulf's Norman Cathedral. Today, the person responsible for the care of this lovely building is the Dean, and the very Reverend John Arnold, Rochester's Dean, has a rather unusual talent. How many people do you know who speak fluent Russian, for instance?
Now, nice.
You had a very important reason for speaking Russian, didn't you?
Well, Russian has been tremendously important for me as part of my faith, because one of the things which helped me to come to the faith was reading the great Russian novelists, and that's something that helps Russians to come to the Christian faith today. And although I learnt Russian in order to be able to use it for military purposes, in fact, I've never fired a Russian word in anger, but have been able to use it, by the grace of God, in the service of the Prince of Peace, for the churches and their relations with each other. And I'm very grateful to have had that opportunity.
And of course, you've been to Russia many times, haven't you?
Yes, half a dozen times. Yes.
Have you had any conversation with dissidents in Russia?
Yes, I've mostly visited the official overground churches, which have millions of members. But the last time I was there, I was able to go and visit the wife of a prisoner, a man who's in prison for his faith. This was a deeply moving visit after a complicated journey by cab. We found our way to a flat, the address of which we had on a scrap of paper, met a young woman who had two small children. She invited us into her flat and was very open with us. I was immensely impressed by their courage, and perhaps the most moving moment of all was just to kneel on the floor with them and to pray with them. And behind her head on the wall was a portrait of the husband and father who was in prison. And round it, stenciled in, was a cross of thorns, light on one side, dark on the other. Unforgettable moment.
Just how strong is Christianity in Russia then?
Of course, in the last 70 years since the revolution, it's had no official public role, but the Russian people have kept the faith. Statistics aren't easy to come by. They're probably underestimated rather than overestimated, but there must be at least 50 million Orthodox Christians in Russia. There aren't enough churches for them. They're not allowed to evangelize in public, but they keep the faith, and it's a faith that's very strong.
It's very hopeful for the rest of the world then, isn't it?
I think that it's very hopeful, particularly for people who may be facing hard days. These are people who've come through a great tribulation, and they've shown that a message of hope, of love, of reconciliation can prevail over the worst that the world can hurl at them.
Breathing.
Right.
Right, James, what was your mistake?
I started from the wrong verse.
Right, so which is it, 23? Okay, let's agree. Everybody breathing.
Under the expert eye of the choir master, Barry Ferguson, Rochester Cathedral's young singers carefully prepare for every service.
Now, you're going to tell us about these people. What are you going to tell us? Go on. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is gracious. Let's just say that again. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is gracious. And not gracious. Just say it again. Gracious. Well, you say it very nicely. Remember to do that when you sing. Let's try again. Okay.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is gracious.
107th Psalm to a setting by a former organist, Dr. Robert Ashfield. Now, here in the chancel is this magnificent carved wooden stall. It's the cathedral throne of the Bishop of Rochester. It might seem a bit high to you, but to the present bishop, that can be a help. Bishop Davis, say?
Sir Harry, we warmly welcome you to this cathedral and delighted to see you here.
Thank you. You're the 104th Bishop of Rochester, yes, and the Lord High Almoner.
Yes.
How do you get that appointment?
This is a personal appointment of the Queen. I'm a member of her household and responsible for the Royal Maundy service each year, wherever it's held. She came here in 1961 to distribute the Royal Maundy, as King John had done in Rochester in 1215. And all down the centuries in between, this annual commemoration, well, that is what it is, of our Lord's own action of washing his disciples' feet and of giving them the new commandment to love one another, has been commemorated.
It's an honour, then.
Well, it has become that, because what they have done in their local community in a whole variety of ways is... Well, I find it one of those things which revives one's faith in the whole sort of voluntary principle, which is, I think, a very important part of our English way of life.
May I see some of the money?
Yes, here are the four coins. They are freshly minted each year, and they are the coins of the realm. You could go and buy a stamp with it if you wanted
to. Could you really, yes.
But you'd be very ill-advised.
Well, sadly, the time has come for us to leave Rochester. I shall take away a lesson I learned from the very Reverend John Arnold, Dean of Rochester, who taught me that martyrs are not just people who lived hundreds of years ago. No, there are modern martyrs the world over who are ready to suffer for their faith. Next week, Harry goes to Carrickfergus. I'll see you there.